Hello and welcome back here to Heroes of the Dorm, the round of 64. My name is SolidJake and I'm joined here at the desk by the one and only Gillyweed.
Jake, I am so excited that we get to be here. You know, there are more than $500,000 in scholarships up for grab, as well as the prizing for these teams. So it's an honor to be a part of this, but the action's actually been going on for a little while now.
Yeah, it certainly has, and you know what? We want to make sure you guys are completely up to speed, so let's take a look at the competition overview. Now, the tournament began with the online qualifiers back on February 20th, where teams competed from across North America online. Here we are at the bracket play, where it is now single elimination, where teams are trying to vie for those spots in the Heroic Four, which will be happening April 9th and 10th. Of course, there are 64 teams in total, and 16 teams from each of our regions will be advancing into the A, B, C, and D bracket.
And speaking of that bracket, we know you guys have been filling out your bracket challenge online at home, and we do have a little bit of information about how that's been going, who you guys think are going to be winning this, so we can take a look at that. Arizona State seems to be the top team people are expecting to win, but it wasn't as high as I thought it was going to be. 10% so far, yeah, of the people who filled it out are expecting Arizona State to win the entire competition. So I really, you know, I think a lot of people thought with Arizona State how strong they were looking, then maybe that percentage would have been higher. So it's cool to see that there's a lot of maybe loyalty to their teams or just a lot of different opinions going out as people fill on this bracket challenge.
I got to say, though, I'm impressed with the world. They see the power of UConn. They've got 6% chance to advance. You know,
you and UConn
in that first place spot. And I agree wholeheartedly with that, that they have a very high chance of being one of those 64 teams to go all the way. Now, Gillyweed, this is indeed our third match of the competition, but what did you think of the first two today?
Well, I love seeing some murky, of course. I really like having all of those interesting picks that have already been coming out, and I'm hoping that you and I maybe will get to see some more pretty awesome picks. Specifically thinking of the last matchup that Jake and I will get to cast today, that's going to be pretty epic. We have two teams that are, you know, kind of known for those pocket strategies.
Yeah, well, let's take a look at Bracket C, where we will be moving into next four today, and we will be casting Florida State versus Indiana, the Mighty Churros versus the Crab Legs.
It's the food match, Jake.
Mm-hmm.
I hope you ate your lunch.
I did not, and this is going to make it difficult, but they're going to make it interesting for us. So the Crab Legs, I mean, 6-0 so far. They didn't lose a single game during their qualifiers.
Right. It was a little bit more difficult for Indiana to make it through here, as evidenced by not only their wins and losses, but also their average game length. Mm. It's much longer. And when you see a team who is undefeated and has a short average game time, it shows that they're really rocking their way through the bracket thus far. But they're a very aggressive team, and they really like to invade their opponent's mercenary camp. So eventually, they're going to get more punished for that. Maybe Indiana is the team to do it.
We'll find out. Let's actually take a closer look at the Florida State Crab Legs and the roster that will be competing in today's matches. Now, we have Dumming, Dumb Hawk, Phelps, Feraligatr, and Shambulance. Gilly, you studied this team quite a bit. What are your thoughts on them, other than just the fact that they like to invade?
Yeah, the invasion is the biggest thing about them. Even when they're even levels, they're going to be looking to do that whenever possible. They feel very confident in their team fighting. An interesting statistic specifically about Shambulance, their team captain, is out of those six qualifying games they've played, he has only died twice.
What?
So he is a fantastic player, really watches his positioning, and that could be an issue for Indiana if they're just undying.
That's rather impressive. Well, it's not going to be an easy battle, though, because they are up against the Mighty Churros, who are here to bring the pain. Now, Indiana University, they have Chris Paul, Graves, Hero, Kaze, and Wilted. And Wilted is really someone you want to be looking out for. He tends to play heroes that can really control the battlefield, whether it's Falstad or Tassadar for the Force Wall and Mighty Gust. He's always going for those mid-range control support-esque heroes. And he's very, very good at doing so. He gets his allies out of a lot of sticky situations, but he also can really seclude single enemy heroes when it matters the most.
And Graves, Kaze, and Wilted actually played in last year's Heroes of the Dorm and made it to the Epic 8. So they've made it pretty far, and they're looking for another long run into this year's tournament.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, with Heroes of the Storm, a lot of the time, you know, teamwork and just having good synergy is more important than actual individual mechanical skill.
Absolutely.
So for that team, having, you know, that much experience together, that could count for quite a bit. moving forward.
Well, I hear that our draft is ready, Jake. So we're going to see what heroes they've chosen to grab, if we're going to have Mighty Churros going once again for a double support composition. And here we have the drafts. Florida State Crab Legs have a lot of their favorite picks right off the bat. I see Diablo, Thrall, and Brightwing. Those are three heroes that they've said they feel very confident when they can get in a draft.
But look at that burst potential, the Leeming, Zeratul, Greymane. If you are caught anywhere out of position, they are going to chunk you down like a little delicious Mighty Churro.
That would make sense, even a crab leg at that. It's the battle of the foods. Do you like crab legs or do you like Mighty Churros better?
I would go for the crab legs yourself.
Oh, I'm from Texas, so dough that's been fried and then covered in sugar is right up my alley.
Okay, guys. Well, we want to know what you guys think about that draft. It's quick, it's hot, but we're here. So let us know on Twitter. Tweet using the hashtag Heroes of the Storm and the team that you think will win this game.
I'm really excited for this match, but I'm a little bit scared for the crab legs. You know, that draft looked very impressive from the Mighty Churros. I'm surprised that they were able to get away with so much, especially for their damage picks. Leeming and Greymane, let alone adding Zeratul to that, the control that Void Prison is going to bring.
Right.
That is an issue, especially for those fights where they're almost forced to constantly get in those big team fights around the temples.
It's going to be dicey. It's like the crab leg crunchers. That's what they've drafted, essentially, and they're going for that. But it sounds like we're ready for our first game on Sky Temple, so let's jump right on into it. On the blue side, it is the Florida State Crab Legs, and we have Dumming, Dumhawk, Phelps, Feraligatr, and Shambulance, respectively.
And playing for the Mighty Churros in red, we have Chris Paul, Graves, Hero, Kaze, and Wilted.
Now remember, this is a best of three series, which means you need to take two maps off your opponents in order to advance into the round of 32, which we played on tomorrow. One chance only. If you lose a best of three series, your chance for eternal glory in Heroes of the Dorm is over.
And this is very important. All of it's so important because of the fact that they're playing for their college tuition. The top five, or the winning five players of the winning team, are the ones who will be able to get their tuition paid for. So a lot is on the line, and it all starts here at the round of 64 now. We have four members of the team of Florida State into the mid. All five of the Mighty Churros are in here as Greymane moves up to the top, actually. Zul has already set up and wants to start pushing into the bottom lane. And that will have to be responded to pretty quick because his pushing power is so strong.
Yeah, so stylistically, just looking at the differences in this team, you just mentioned Zul. He's going to provide this huge threat of pushing out a lane solo. And if they don't respond to it, that can really add up a lot of pressure. But also, the crab legs have Brightwing, and Brightwing gives them global presence as Brightwing is able to teleport across the map from any point to an ally.
Yeah, so they're definitely going to be looking to take advantage of that. You know, they want to keep her in a lane as long as possible, allow the rest of the teammates to be at a temple or at another objective, but she's specifically helping them get ahead in experience. And then Zul as well. You know, we've already seen a Zul on a Sky Temple where he was able to get a lot of push into the bottom lane while everyone else was responding up to the top. It's likely we could see that again, although we do start to see him rotating up already. They want to have everybody here in full force when these temples spawn.
Yeah, if you've ever seen Sky Temple, you know there's always the two temples at the start of the game in the mid and top part of the lane, and here they are being split up individually. The middle temple controlled by the crab legs and the top temple being controlled by the Mighty Churros. So both teams really respecting each other, not looking for any early confrontations. They're kind of looking for their power spikes because, Gilly, I don't know if I would give either team a huge advantage for that early game power.
Yeah, it's really all about crowd control, having the ability to stun or root your opponents, and both sides have pretty good amounts of that. Florida State has a little bit more maybe with their stuns and roots, the slow potential of Jaina, but I totally agree with you there. I like the decision from Mighty Churros to grab the top temple anyway, because of the fact that they had that early push, they're actually going to be able to pick up a fort with that, and that is not something that you often see off of a first temple phase.
No, 2 minute fort going down, Zeratul just barely getting up, blinking at the last moment as the prison did go down from Dumhawk, but we do see Graves will actually be picked off a bit out of position. Now there's Blink just barely being available for Wilted, able to escape the clutches of Phelps.
First blood of the game going toward Florida State Crab Legs. The temple phase has finished, and they're starting to rotate back into the lanes. Brightwing already getting ready to set up top. This is a great decision. We already talked about her global presence. The next temple phase we know is at the bot, so they're able to keep her there as long as possible, get a great push up there, maybe against the towers or the fort as the rest of the team is rotating down, and when she's needed, she can always teleport in to help out her team.
Yeah, and the Indiana Mighty Churros actually pick up that Bruiser Camp a little bit early. Often teams mm-hmm. will delay that a little bit longer to time it with the second temple of the game. You mentioned the temples expired very quickly, so it's not that far away. So I don't know how much damage those knights will actually do.
Well, I think the fact that they had already taken out the fort with the temple, you know, it wasn't as much of a concern for them to try to get that push. They knew that they really wouldn't do too much. Maybe also because of the fact that they have the Brightwing. They knew that they would be trying to keep her up there anyway. It allows them to already just get aggressive in the bottom, try to maybe put some early damage onto these towers so that when they win this temple, then they can get yet another fort away from Florida State.
Okay, Hero just backing on away. They're doing their best to escort these giants as safely as possible. They don't want to overstep their bounds because Florida State is so close to level 7, which is a bit of a power spike for their team. That'll enable them to get new talent and really enhance their capability to dismantle their opponents.
Yep, they've just picked up those now, but Indiana is not far behind. That tower did help them out a lot. For Alligator, starting to work on their own bruiser so that they can have that pushing during the temple phase. And Brightwing actually was forced to come down. So that's a nice pickup that they did have, is that nobody is really soaking that top lane at this point for Florida State, and Indiana have evened up the talent and experience.
Yeah, and she spent phase shift to do that. You know, the clairvoyance will reveal that they're safe, but Shamulet's taking a lot of damage from the poke of Wilted. Forcing Shamulet to tap the well before this next temple phase is actually a rather massive deal that it's just you don't have the additional health or mana pool to tap in the middle of a fight.
Right, it's more difficult to re-engage because if you need that, you have to go all the way back and run back in. And we do see that Thrall did that so that he will still be able to do that. Sometimes we see that from team members as they'll choose to go back. Shambulance takes massive amounts of damage already from that arcane orb.
Okay, we see Kaze was able to teleport to safety after Brightwing did spend her poly on her. Let's uncool down for a bit. Shambulance very low in the back, but poking as safely as they can. Kaze teleporting as closely as he can to his safe. But we see the Bone Prison will go down, and that will be a deadly Ming. First blood of this fight, we see Dumbhawk trying to back away, but Wilted still has Blink available on his radar. So two kills might end up going down here as Dumbhawk is getting chunked, but Wilted has that Bone Prison, and there's no safety for him. For Alligator with the charge is enough for the kill.
Man, Feraligator is ferocious on Diablo. It's his favorite to play, at least the one I was seeing him play the most in the group stage. And the fact that they were able to keep everyone alive there was so key. They did not even lose Zul. And he does have the ability to gain a little bit of health whenever he raises a skeleton with this trait. That is the level 7 talent he picked up. So he does have a little bit of self-sustain, and Thrall does as well. So I like that they've done this. They know that Brightwing does not have a ton of heals available for them. She's a little bit more healing over time with her Soothing Mist. So having that self-sustain is really helping them and enabled them to get the rest of that temple.
Yeah, unless for the temple, they're almost level 10, which mm-hmm. will give them that massive advantage for their heroic abilities. If they can find heroes out of position like this, they might lose that advantage, but Phelps is looking to turn things around. The phase shift in from Brightwing, and it's just going to be a full disengage.
Now they have picked up their heroic abilities. They're starting to grab them. We are going to see Apocalypse will be the choice for Diablo. So yeah, it's going to be a lot more control.
Whoa.
And Ring of Frost added to that.
So the power of Apocalypse and Sundering together, and then you throw the Skeletal Mages into the mix
right.
with Ring of Frost, this could be crazy control. But I don't think we'll see Emerald Wind out of Brightwing, because that's a little too all in. Yes, it is going to be
Poison. I like the Skeletal Mage. I believe that's the first time we're seeing Skeletal Mages today. It's been the Poison Nova thus far. So we'll see how that's going to work out for them. The big deal is that they do throw them down. It's kind of like a line, sort of like Force Wall, but then the fact that you also get the slows off of that, they really will have a lot of control, just like you said. An invade here from Florida State. They knew their opponents didn't quite have heroic abilities yet, so they're able to just steal away these giants. Tends to be whatever you try to do if you get those heroic abilities first.
Okay, well, the bottom fort being pressured heavily. Do we see a flanker on the back? No, because we have Greymane way out of position, still in the top lane, so there's no chance they can fight this. They just have to concede and give up this structure.
Now, we're going to see them rotate back out. Indiana was just into all of the lanes already. They knew they couldn't really deal with that, and they needed to catch up with experience where they can. They're still a level behind Florida State, and the next temple phase is about to spawn in 15 seconds.
Okay, so things are rather even. Florida State does have about a level lead, which mm-hmm. is nothing massive at this point since it's not a talent tier disadvantage for the side of the Mighty Churros. But they need to figure out exactly how they want to approach this. They're a little split up right now. Greymane seems like he's kind of, you know, indecision as to where he wants to go, and now they're opting to all five go to the bottom and contest the Crab Legs.
Yeah, they know that they need to get into a fight before they get down again, but a big blizzard is going to dismount a whole bunch of them into a Ring of Frost. Rhaegar is already taken out of this. The Sundering throws two more members in Zeratul's taken out as well. The Bone Prison not going to allow Greymane to escape. And just like that, Florida State get a 3-4-0.
Gillyweed, the Mighty Churros just walked down an alleyway in a dumpster, fell off the roof of a building onto three of their members. I mean, that was painful.
It was painful. And that furthers the experience advantage for Florida State. Now where they were only a level down, Indiana sees themselves at a full level and a half. Florida State have grabbed their 13 talents as well, and they're getting a full value out of that bottom temple.
Well, we do see just the experience starting to really, you know, propel forward in favor of the Crab Legs, over two level advantage for them at this point in time. Brightwing controlling that bottom lane, getting that soak, but might be flanked upon as Zeratul is scouting the area, but has no idea that Deathclaw is going to be going up to the top part of the map.
So it's so nice to be able to take out Zeratul so early, because it's great. And now there is Bone Prison into the Overpower, and a Hero taken out quickly. And this is what I'm talking about. Florida State, they had the aggressive invade into the Giants on the side of Mighty Churros. They're aggressively trying to pick people off. This is what they do. They're totally in the zone at this point.
Yeah, and you know, that big cooldown on the Ancestral Heal, I mean, you saw it there. Typically, you expect Rhaegar to be able to get a lot of heroes out of those situations, but still another 30 seconds for that, so it wasn't available in that moment. So Diablo just controlling that shrine while the rest of the team, they maximize their experience, they're rotating around, they're collecting mercenary camps, and they're really doing a great job just spreading out and making sure to make the most out of that kill.
Florida State got both of the temples, but the bottom fort did get taken out by Indiana. They were at least able to push in there, knowing that most of the people were up top dealing with the fort, so they wouldn't be able to try to defend it as much. So that is a nice pickup for them. They're about to get their level 13 talents too, so they're catching up in at least in the tiers, and they potentially could find a place to fight here. They need to try to at least get back a little bit, find some of that comeback experience before Florida State get to level 16.
Okay, Diablo just doing a good job scouting out the flanks, making sure his team is A-okay to grab this aggressive invade. You mentioned they like to do this style of stuff, and they're doing exactly that whenever they can.
Yeah, they're going to continue doing that, and they're grouping around the boss at this point. Now, this is a place that if Indiana realizes this, they know that they're pretty much all off the battleground. Jaina is the only one that is in the lane clearing out minions, and they immediately recognize that this is exactly where they're at. But what are they going to do? The Giants will be pushing this entire time. The boss, about a quarter of a health, Jake. I don't know how this is going to work out.
Okay, Wilton manages to blink right as the prison does go off. So the Bone Prison has been spent, but so has Blink. The boss is very low, but is the throw pit real? It's an even Talonflame footing. Hero goes in, a huge bomb coming out from Li Ming, and the Ring of Frost does some massive damage. They force them off the point. They control the boss, but do they pay with their lives? Diablo will respawn. Rhaegar has gone down. It's two down on the side of the Crab Legs, and the Mighty Churros are trying to get one more. Hero needs to be careful because he is low on health, but it looks like it's just going to be a defense of the boss.
That Sundering was so key in throwing members of Indiana off of the point so that they could still cap it. And now the boss plus all the Giants that were picked up earlier have meant that the wall is already down. This is pushing onto the keep specifically. And bam, temples activate just like that. Florida State is on fire right now.
Yeah, this is like the worst case scenario. I mean, Diablo, his trait is to respawn if he has enough souls. So he's pretty much right back in the action after he died in that battle. Now Thrall's respawning, so they're going to be at full power with a talent tier advantage going into this next temple phase, and their fortifications in the mid and bottom lane are already very much exposed due to that big push they earned themselves.
Such good decision-making coming from Florida State. They knew that the response would be there in the bottom for the boss, and so they pushed into the mid, took out a couple of the towers, so that way when they get this temple, it will have a lot more value. It's going to start attacking the keep specifically instead of wasting shots on the towers. And Mighty Churros still don't have 16, so it's a problem for them to try to get in here and really try to engage on it. They're stuck between a rock and a hard place.
Yeah, and they have 20 seconds until Void Prison is ready. So if they can get level 16 themselves, have Void Prison available, and Ancestral Heal available for Zeratul and Rhaegar, they can look to take a fight. But they just lost their first keep in this game. Dumbhawk is trying to get out of there. He will be A-okay with the shields coming out there from himself. But this is still a very, very, you know, time-sensitive moment for Indiana to find that opportunity.
It is, but they are about to hit 16, like you said, and the Void Prison is now ready. They could start to look for it. Wilted is rotating around from the side. We'll see Phelps rotating up too, and going to try to take the Vision Tower. There's a few shots left, about halfway done on this temple too. So now that Indiana have 16, they really are going to try to look to get in here some way, somehow, and start this fight.
Okay, I love the totem pickups here at level 16 for Rhaegar. It's going to give them just a lot of power in the front line. And the big VP onto targets. Brightwing locked just outside of it, but they're a little bit scrambling to go down to Dumbhawk, trying to blow him up, but the heals are sufficient, and the big Apocalypse scatters the entire team of the Mighty Cheros. Hero trying to stay alive with that Avatar and does do so, and leaming from behind with the reset. Not enough for Thrall, but she's still throwing out abilities left after right. Phelps was so low, but Deathclaw managed to sustain, but Deathclaw will end up going down herself. And now Hero is completely separated from his team. The trades are rather even, but it looks like it will be in favor of the Crab Legs.
Just slightly, but Graves and Li Ming are still on the chase, at least for a bit, but they realize there's still a little bit of the tempo left. They'll have to be okay with that. They did what they could, but still, with losing out 3 versus 2, they still find themselves behind, but at least it's only about a level, and they still have time potentially for another fight. The big deal too, though, for structurally, is they have catapults pushing in toward the mid, and then on the bottom and the top, they're both so low, so at any point, if Florida State can get a really big win in a team fight, it will be game over.
Yeah, I mean, a single temple will put Indiana like at near death position for this game.
Yeah.
So they have to be incredibly careful, and they're still behind. So if they're in a situation where they don't have level 20 and their opponents do going into the next temple phase, it's gonna be a dicey one. They need to find a fight before the next temple phase for sure.
Now, Jaina did pick up Northern Exposure, so if she can get that Cone of Cold and focus down on a target, they really have the ability to blow someone up on the side of Indiana, and we've been seeing the power of that. In the last fight, the Sunders have been so good from Thrall. In the last fight, the Apocalypse was great, too. The fact that it took them just long enough to try to all move from the Void Prison down to Zul, the Apocalypse was able to save the day, and they've done a great job of keeping each other alive just in the thick of things, but we're gonna have another fight, Jake.
Okay, a beautiful VP on 3 targets. They're looking for Brightwing. Deathclaw is very low in the backside. The Void Prison has worn off, but the massive damage going out. Apocalypse connecting on 3 out of 5 members, and Chris Paul gonna be caught by that Bone Prison. He will go down first, and it looks like we have Florida State charging in. Now, Deathclaw has to back out from that poke from Li Ming from afar, and he's still alive, but this is not going to be a game-winning push on the side of Florida State.
Yeah, but they do get the bottom keep. The top keep should be easy enough to rotate to and take out as well. And Deathclaw was low, but the power of Brightwing, you just go back and then you teleport right back in. There goes an overpower onto Muradin. They know that if they can get just a couple of more kills, it will be game over. They will win game one, so they're trying to find it, but they have to be careful because as long as they're in here, they are taking some poke damage.
Yeah.
And there's a temple as well.
Well worth the push, though. They go down to the bottom lane. They're just about level 20. They know they have the advantage, and as long as they can control this bottom temple, it's going to put them very close to a victory.
Right. And if they can pick up their level 20, there's a big push of minions and mercenaries on top, so that will give them more experience. They'll have those storm tier talents, and they've already started picking up that temple. Now, the boss is already also available, but I think the fight will just happen around this temple. And if
no Jaina, no Thrall, no Gray Mane, no Li Ming. So it's a 3v3 here in the bottom right now as 4 members are still making their way to this battle. 20 just around the corner for Florida State. That's going to give them a huge power spike in this battle, basically making it their fight to lose.
And Mighty Churros really want to get into the fight before they hit that point, but there goes the Storm Bolt onto Thrall. Can they actually do it? He has to Dwarf Toss away, and Florida State just trying to delay as long as possible. They're even willing to give up some of the shots just so they can get level 20 before they get into that big fight.
Okay, 2 seconds on Apocalypse, 5 seconds on Ancestral Heal. Pretty much everything will be ready for this battle. But look at the core. Starting to take some damage. A big VP does go down, and they're forcing down Dumbhawk. They pick him off. This is huge here for the Mighty Churros. They're trying to move on in. A big Ring of Frost does pick up the single kill, and they're managing to focus down Greymane as well. Without those two heroes, there's nowhere near enough damage on the side of Indiana. But as I say that, Li Ming proves me wrong. She's getting the reset on her abilities, doing so much to the rest of the team, and now it's a 3v3.
They get away from the Disintegrate. They're still just trying to get shots, maybe force the members of Indiana to come in here. They know that it's a game over situation either way. So they can force them in, and they can try to hit them with all of Jaina's big abilities.
Hero.
And Hero is so low, the Blizzard takes him out, and now Diablo is on the chase, flips Graves into the rest of the team, and he takes a bunch more damage from the Fire Stomp. Still just trying to maybe delay them from picking this up and
Gillyweed,
making a lot of them go
away. The core is at 40%. The temple is powering it through, and the Crab Legs are looking to be your winners for game number one in this best of 3 series. Are the final shots enough? It's gonna be so close. Yes!
Yeah! Just enough. Great job by the Crab Legs controlling the battleground, controlling the objectives all throughout that game, Jake.
Some really impressive play. I mean, we saw some good response, a good desperate attempt at the end to take that fight before level 20 was achieved by the Crab Legs, and they almost had it. Just a few mistakes made there. They got the kill on Dumb Hawk, which was critical, but they clumped up a bit too much for that Apocalypse, which seemed to be like the game-winning move for them.
I told you, man, this guy loves his Diablo, and they really like this controlling heroics, like the Apocalypse, the Sundering, even the Ring of Frost. They were able to make it all work, and when you have so many heroics like that are controlling how many people are around and able to really move, you can sometimes not have that synergy, but they did a great job of pulling all of that off.
And I gotta really hand it to our Zul player, because every single time Zeratul went in to pressure the team, he would cast Bone Prison. And Bone Prison is a 2-second activate where it will then root you for 2 seconds. Mm-hmm. Zeratul knew he had to find a way to get to safety, blink over the wall, and completely abandon his attempts to dismantle the enemy team.
Yeah, they did a really good job with that, because Void Prison really is the biggest problem for that team. If you get a really good Void Prison, it is a game changer at any point. So just being able to constantly watch out for him, throw that Bone Prison down immediately, showing that they've been able to pick up this new hero and really run with it.
Yeah, well, great targeted response to one of the aces of the team of the Mighty Churros, Wilted. So they are now down 0-1 to the Crab Legs, sitting in a nice spot here after game number one. But of course, guys, we've got more action coming. But before we go to a commercial break, we want you to head to heroesofthedorm.com to get more information about the teams. You can check out your own bracket, see how you're doing on your predictions, and much, much more. Stay tuned. We'll be back with game two in just a few. Alrighty, guys, welcome back here to Heroes of the Dorm, the round of 64 with SolidJake and Gillyweed.
And we are right in the middle of a series between the Florida State Crab Legs and the Indiana Mighty Churros, with Florida State up 1-0 in this best of three.
Yeah, decisive game. You know, we had some amazing, amazing playmakers in that game, but Gilly, who excited you the most?
Well, I really liked Dumb Hawk. The fact that he was able to pick up Zul, the newest hero, and totally run with him, I love how much we've been seeing. And we can actually take a closer look at some of the stats about Dumb Hawk.
Well, actually, you know, let's talk a little bit about Feraligatr as well, because Feraligatr, he has a fantastic Diablo. He has a fantastic name. It makes me think of the alligators that are outside trying to eat me when I go in the woods.
Yeah, I mean, they are from Florida State, so that makes sense. Nice. And here is Feraligatr playing that Diablo. I mentioned that they have been playing, it's just Diablo and Johanna, by the way, thus far, all the way through the group stage. So he really likes the Lord of Terror, and it makes sense. That was a clutch pick for them. The Apocalypse were very on point, and they constantly were controlling their opponents.
Lord Dibbles himself dismantling the opponents throughout the game. And guys, our next battleground is going to be Battlefield of Eternity. So this kind of shakes things up a bit, because Battlefield of Eternity changes the dynamic a little bit when it comes to the way that you draft in this game.
Yeah, it really does. You have to focus on damage dealers who can continually put damage onto the Immortals. That's a very important point. Vision is so important as well when it comes to this, because of the fact of how the center area is. There is a lot of open space and a lot of vents, so if you can get some good vision-granting heroes like Zagara, Tassadar as well, it's great too. And then melee assassins are a big key because of how much damage they can do, and the fact that there's a lot of places to be able to scoot around and maybe catch somebody out of position.
Well, let's take a look at the heat map here for Battlefield of Eternity to take a look exactly where you should be seeing all the action. Now, the Immortals are centered in the middle of the map, and that's where all the big fights happen. You'll see just constant team fights whenever those Immortals are being vied for. Also, you'll see that the top lane on the blue side, the bottom lane on the red side, for whatever reason, that just happens to be where teams try to push and tend to fail.
Yeah, maybe they get a little ham with those Immortals, but the big deal is that center area, and there's a lot of space between the two lanes on this battleground, and it takes a while to get through the rotations. The center gate from both base does help you get into that center area faster, but that is where a lot of the action takes place. The fights are pretty long around those Immortals.
So stylistically, we could see early Zagara bans, potentially early Zagara picks. Some teams will play Sergeant Hammer on this map. Yes, a fan favorite that's not very common in competitive Heroes of the Storm. So that could be very exciting. And even Nazebo might see some good strong play here.
I was so excited that we saw Nazebo.
Yeah, me too.
That was really cool.
On Shrines, the zombie wall just controlled so much space, and those spiders just kept nipping at the heels of those minions. really fun.
Jake, I want to hear about your alligator Nazebo skin idea.
Oh, man. Okay. I want like basically Crocodile Hunter Nazebo, where you have an alligator version of a gargantuan. You have little baby alligators instead of frogs. And, of course, snakes instead of spiders. The reptilian version of Nazebo would be really fun because he's already gross and slimy, right?
He is very
Makes
gross
sense.
Slimy. Well, we'll see if that happens. But for now, I'm really excited to see what they're going to draft and what Indiana needs to do differently. You know, they had the Zeratul, which is a key tool in really being able to come back in fights, being able to get a lot of heroes in the Void Prison and then be able to take out those who weren't in it. But it really just worked for them that one time with Zul. And even then, they didn't get a lot done with it.
Alrighty, well, it sounds like we're actually ready to roll with the draft. So let's hop into game number two's draft, which is actually well underway. Excellent. So we can actually see that the first band in this draft was Falstad, followed by Thrall. And then we had the first pick of Zagara. We mentioned her priority in this battleground.
Absolutely. Zagara is very important. And Tyrande is another really big pick because of the fact that her Hunter's Mark, she can place it on the Immortals, and then they will be vulnerable to damage. So that helps them be able to burn down those Immortals faster. I like the Thrall ban, by the way, from Indiana. They realized how great Florida State was with them. It's a big comfort pick, so they're taking that away from them.
Yeah, but this is actually really similar to game number one. We saw the Li Ming Gray main, you know, right? Like burst together. Now you have a Hunter's Mark with Lunar Flare. Mm-hmm. Again, so a very burst-oriented composition. But Florida State, they have their Diablo. They have that comfort of the massive control with Maw and Apocalypse.
Right. They do, once again, have Diablo. And I spoke about Thrall being a comfort pick, but when their Thrall player can't get him, Raynor is who he wants to play. And Raynor on Battlefield of Eternity anyway is a great pickup as well, because whereas you might not see him so much in some of the other battlegrounds, the fact that he can put that consistent damage onto the Immortals will help them along with Zagara in being able to kind of race the opponent team when they're trying to take those down.
Yeah, it's definitely going to be really interesting. So Wilted, there's going to be probably no Zeratul. Wilted will likely be on that Tyrande in this game. And they've already got their double supports. We'll see what warrior they end up going for. They tend to go for the Muradin. He's still on the table. Could be that last pick here on the side of Indiana.
Muradin and Tyrande are often paired together. I know you call them the Miranda pair because of the fact that you can get an easy stun with Muradin and then follow it up with a Lunar Flare, throw the Hunter's Mark on, and someone is stun locked for a long time, not being able to get away from all of the damage that Indiana can throw down. Especially once you get go to the throat, that'll be terrifying.
Oh, we're seeing Lili and Sonya. Now, Lili is not a very common hero in competitive Heroes of the Storm. She throws little cups of healing brew everywhere. She blinds her opponents, and she summons dragons to help fight for her.
The blind will be nice. I mean, Greymane, he throws out the Gilnean Cocktail. It won't do with that, but still with his auto attacks, especially once he goes into his Worgen form. But here we see Lili, their abilities, and that.
Those are nice icons.
Yeah, art is just so awesome.
I'm really happy with all the new art they're showing us off today. I'm privileged to see it with you guys. And here we are going into the final pick of the Indiana Mighty Churros. Now, they need a warrior. We talked about the power of Meriden, but ETC could also be a very powerful pick in this spot.
Yeah, looking at what they will have to try to deal with a mosh pit and stop it, Raynor will be a very key to being able to stop the mosh pit. But they do still have that. We'll see what warrior they're going to add. Either of those pairs really well with Trana and will be a great frontliner for all of the damage dealers they have on the team.
Now, Muradin, there it is. So Muradin will be that last pickup that is very much a comfort pick on the side of their team and a strong pairing with that hero, Tyrande, like we mentioned. Gilly, what do you think about these drafts?
I'm really happy with both of them. I think that both of them made sure to draft some heroes who would be good for the Immortals. Mm-hmm. They made sure that they got some comfort picks as well on their side so that they're feeling good going into this. And they've got a lot of damage for team fights. So overall, I'm very happy with both of the drafts. What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, the Mighty Churros, they definitely have the stronger early game, in my opinion, just the power of Miranda alone. If you get caught out of position, you're going to be burned down very quickly. So for the early fights over those Immortals, you know, we're going to have to see some pretty safe play on the side of the Crablegs.
Yeah, generally when we go through through these Immortal fights, it's either they try to just race each other as fast as possible to try to take it down, or we'll see a team try to defend if they feel like they've got a pretty, they're not having to deal with too much poke. They can just try to defend it, maybe force their opponents into some of the stuns that the Immortals push out. Or, of course, you can try to fight underneath your opponent's Immortals, but that's a very, very risky play.
Right, so there's a lot of strategy when it comes to just battling over the Immortals in general. Basically, when the Immortal reaches 50% health, it will reposition. So both of them will will reset and move into a new phase. This forces the teams to scramble, relocate, and potentially, you know, take a fight in that moment where they are separating or go back to the lanes to soak the experience. It's only a two-lane map, which is rather different from a lot of the maps here in Heroes of the Storm, but maintaining that soak, maintaining that, you know, experience in those lanes is also a very critical thing. We don't really have a lot of, you know, global soak heroes like Abathur or Lost Vikings to help these teams for that in particular, but it's still something you want to try to rotate around, quickly clear the lane of minions, and then get back to the action at the Immortals.
Yeah, we don't even have something like a Falstad or a Brightwing. So they will have to be really cognizant of the fact that if they go to the lanes and they need to come back for a fight, it's going to take a bit for them to rotate back in to those fights at the Immortals. So we're going to see how each team chooses to address the Immortal phase. This is probably my favorite battleground, actually, to commentate.
Just
strictly, strictly because I love the strategy around the Immortal fights. It's so fun to watch.
I'd have to go with Infernal Shrines myself. I mean, watching the Punisher just throw people against walls. Oh, that new Carbots video. Shout out to Carbots.
So good!
He makes some of the funniest videos on the internet. Really cool stuff. But, of course, guys, we're getting set up here for the second map. This is currently a 1-0 lead for the Crablegs. But and the other thing to really watch out for is just the power of Hunter's Mark when it comes to fighting those Immortals, because it really just, you know, amplifies the damage received on that target by 25%, and it's rather significant. So we want to hear exactly what you guys think about these drafts and who you think will advance. Be sure to tweet at us, use the hashtag Heroes of the Dorm, and the team that you think that will win this game.
I'm wondering if Florida State is going to close it out right here with a 2-0, or if we're going to see Indiana be able to bring it back and have a game number three. I'm kind of partial to being able to have a game number three. These guys have been playing it pretty fun. It's been really fun to be able to watch.
They're picking some of my favorite heroes. I mean, if you pick Greymane and you go for that burst style paired with Li Ming, I'm rooting for you. I mean, Indiana, Mighty Churros, you sound delicious. Prove to me that you're more tasteful than the crab legs. Prove it.
Jake has given you a mission, Mighty Churros. Now, you're talking about the Hunter's Mark, and that is a really big concern, specifically because it might change the strategy and what we'll see the Florida State Crablegs choose to do around the Immortal fights. They may have to alter their strategy and have to try to defend their own Immortal where they would want to be trying to take them down. You know, they may even do something where they try to take Raynor away and have him attack while they choose to defend.
All right, we'll see. It sounds like we're ready to roll into game number two on the Battlefield of Eternity. So let's jump right on in where the teams are now spawning.
All right, in the blue, we have Florida State Crablegs up 1-0 in this best of three with Dumming playing that Lili. We've got Dumb Hawk, Phelps, Feraligatr, and Shambulance.
And on the red side, that is the Mighty Churros with Chris Paul on Greymane, Graves playing Karazim, Hero going to be on Muradin, Kaze playing Li Ming, and Wilted on Tyrande.
Now, speaking of Tyrande, we've talked a lot about Hunter's Mark, but the fact that the Sentinel is going out already, that will be a constant throughout this game. She can always be checking to see where the other team is, especially around those mercenary camps. It's really important to be able to see where your opponents are at if they want to try to invade, or even just to try to rotate somewhere else, knowing where they are at. And as well, we've got Li Ming going for the Cloud Serpent build overall. We'll see if that continues. Conjurers, not necessarily something that we see a lot of teams pick up because of the fact that you are fighting out of lane for so long around those Immortals. See if it seems like all of the teams so far not really into that, but we already have a fight going down. Hunter's Mark onto Phelps. Gonna have to try to get away. It looks like Feraligatr trying to maybe get Hero back into his team. So both teams just trading out some pretty even damage thus far.
Yeah, they're just kind of spreading out, making sure they can poke the best they can, trying to get that nice 4-1 push, but the 4-1 defense is working out relatively well. Zagara will slowly but surely poke down that lane from Karazim.
Right.
He's pretty good at holding the lane, but the minions, those roaches and hydralisks, they are going to become quite the problem. And oh my goodness, Raynor! Good night, sweet prince.
Nowhere are you safe, Raynor. Even with Give Me More, even with 50% increased healing from your adrenaline rush, it won't be able to sustain through that kind of damage as the Lunar Flare takes them out and gives Indiana first blood.
All right, well, Zagara, you see she has that creep sprint all over this top lane that gives her vision, movement speed, and health regeneration. But if she stands into all of the punches of Graves, she'll take a good bit of damage. So she should be playing a little bit more passively when it comes to going face-to-face with any hero.
Looks like the Sentinel pickup Empower will allow Tyrande to have her abilities a little bit quicker, and the Immortal phase has started. And for now, both teams are just choosing to trade out. But it is Gilly. Indiana who is winning.
The power of Hunter's Mark. Look at the health. You can see it on the right side of the screen just above the minimap. Hunter's Mark went down the moment the entire team got there for that fight, and they chunked through its health so much more efficiently than the side of Florida State.
So at this point, Florida State, I think, just realizing that they can't try to deal with this now, they're just going to try to take out as much as possible from Belleth, the side of the red. The more health they can take away from it, the less amount of shields that Illyrian will, or the Belleth will spawn once he comes in and starts pushing down. So it's not a fully shielded, but it is still going to be able to do a little bit damage for longer.
All right, well, we do see that the Immortal will go into the top lane, and we are actually going to have a bit of a split push. They're looking to capitalize on this by pushing down the forts, the towers, here in the bottom, and Indiana will get themselves a nice, quick experience lead. Zagara, as strong as she is as a laner, cannot hold off four opposing heroes.
Yeah, the Immortals get stronger the longer the game goes on. So knowing that this is a fairly weaker one, I love the decision to have a split push going on. They still have Karazim up here to be able to start to get experience once the minions start to push out. But they were able to get a lot more towers down, and that means that they will be able to just start to move ahead in experience.
Yeah, I mean, basically, they're just taking away some of the safety that exists for the crab legs right now. They're getting closer to finding their way towards those healing wells. If they can destroy the sippy cups, the healing wells of their opponents, they make them much more vulnerable. Graves, in a bit of a dicey spot, will be able to radiant dash. There he goes, back to his safety. Gonna tap his own well.
Meanwhile, Florida State is playing pretty passively, knowing the power of Indiana, and here they are going to jump in as Chris Paul goes into his Worgen form. Deathclaw nearly gets taken out. Kaze is trying to chase, but gets hit away from Diablo, and now the fight is turning. Good Lunar Flare will stop it from continuing.
That was really back and forth, really even a lot of close calls on both sides, but good on the allies of either team to get their friends out of a bad spot.
This is Zagara versus Karazim left unchecked. She's going to be able to deal some serious damage, and that will be a nearly one more tower down. Trying to do just what you said, take away some of the safety, try to take some of those towers for experience, and so that once you get the Immortals, they'll be pushing on the more critical structures like the forts.
Yeah, all right, so we do have a bruiser camp being worked on here on the right side. Chris Paul and friends will pick those up, the Fallen Shaman, which do push very, very hardly if they're not responded to. Sentinel revealing that this Kozra camp was picked up here in the bottom lane by Florida State, and Indiana will likely look to just respond in the top, actually, going for Dumbhawk. Hunter's Mark has been cast, but no follow-up available, so he will get out unscathed.
I love that decision to rotate up and try to get Cigar, knowing that the rest of the team was down on the Kozra, but they didn't quite get her. But now we've got a response from Florida State. You have to respect these bruisers. You cannot let them go ahead and push unchecked while the Immortals, while you're fighting around the Immortals. But this does allow Indiana the potential to get to the Immortals and set up around those a lot quicker. And as we see, once again, Illyrian going down very quickly.
Some interesting things going on in this game. We can see the Shadow Charge forward onto Greymane, but he's able to use that disengage to get back to safety. I want to talk about this Water Dragon build. It's Lili. It's just going all in on the Cloud Serpent. Might go for the Water Dragon if she truly believes in snakes, but Kaze believes in death as he is going to fall down into the depths.
That's the first kill for Florida State, so now they can start to feel the momentum a bit. They know that they can move in onto Belleth and start to put some poke damage on him themselves, but there is still going to be a lot of poke coming out from Greymane with those Gilnane cocktails. They need to be very careful not to get hit by those stuns around Belleth as they're trying to force into the middle point where they can then back up, go get some healing if they need to, get some more mana before the next phase of the fight.
Yeah, so that one kill that was picked up there by Florida State bought them just such an advantage when it came to fighting over these Immortals. Although they don't have Hunter's Mark, they have a huge lead going in, and they will be picking up the oh my goodness, as I say that, the race is happening, and it will actually be just barely lost.
Wow. Yeah, that's the power. I mean, Li Ming rotated back in. The respawn timer's still pretty low, and that enabled her to get back in. So even though they were the ones who forced the halfway point, man, you just can't discount Hunter's Mark.
Yeah, it just the health pool of that Immortal just went down so quickly. And now things are once again dead even. But with this Immortal spawning once again on the red side, they're going to look to really press that advantage. It's Karazim versus Zagara, 1v1 atop, in a four-man push trying to escort this already vulnerable lane. Again, look at that healing wall. If they can get it, it's great. Deathclaw does manage to slip away with the fast feet of Lili, and for Alligator trying to get back to safety.
Man, this is so much damage coming out of Indiana.
The Lunar Flare
hits Diablo. Chris Paul going in. Hero with the Dwarf Toss, and Diablo gets taken out. An Arcane Orb eliminates Sonya.
Absolutely. Beautiful play in the missiles. All three connecting. Lunar Flare over the wall. Not quite enough to kill Deathclaw, but still a 3-for-0 in favor of the Indiana Mighty Cheros, who also pick up that bottom fort.
Man, I am becoming a fan of Wilded.
I told you, he's a boss,
play,
man.
Yeah, it is impressive. I wanted to point out that Karazim went for Cleanse. He wants to be able to get one of his friends out of trouble if he needs to instead of the healing. But here we go once again with this fight. How aggressive we see this fantastic poke damage, being able to just slowly whittle down the members. Deathclaw having a really hard time of being able to keep up with this damage.
I mean, Kaze almost landed all three of those arcane missiles onto Lele too. If that connected, that would have been 4 deaths.
Yeah.
So huge, huge plays there. The power of this team moving forward, they now have their heroic abilities. So we have Shadowstalk, Disintegrate, 7-sided strike. They're doing double support and they're actually splitting this up. So this makes, if Diablo steps forward and Karazim is there, he can just chunk through his health pool.
Yeah, this is actually why I really liked that they also went for a cleanse. They know they have the double support, so they're not as bound to the healing talents of Karazim. And he can pick up that cleanse because there are still a lot of stuns available for Florida State. Now, Dumbhawk is pushing down on the bottom, but the top push for Mighty Churros was great. Florida State didn't have their heroic abilities yet, so they couldn't really do much at all against it.
Gilly, since they have Dumbing and Dumbhawk, can we just call them Dumbing Dumbinger? Hello?
Oh, brilliant.
Beautiful. We did it. All right, well, the bottom lane is actually taking a lot of damage from this Fallen Shaman camp, but it will be cleaned up by Indiana. And we do have the third Immortal phase upon us. 10 seconds, they will spawn in the center of the map, and it looks like Florida State is already in position.
Okay, so they know that they've got some vision for these rotations. We know that they like to go out after some mercenary camps. I wondered if they were going to try to push into there, but it looks like they just want to try to catch out while they can. They know that they have to defend this now, but the Disintegrate does so much damage. 7-sided strike does get soaked up by a lot of members.
Maw only on one. The Apocalypse not doing enough, but Karazim does go down very quickly. This will be a retreat out of the Mycheros, but as I say, that huge damage coming out from Li Ming. We even see the Sentinel with that Hunter's Mark applied in Zagara doing a lot of damage. Hyperion will force them back, but they can tap the well and re-engage.
Versus Li Ming and Greyman with Gilnan Cocktail, Florida State need to be very careful about trying to move into chokes like that. I know that they're trying to be able to use Apocalypse and catch them in that. That's kind of the ideal place for Apocalypse, but they have to be so, so careful versus the damage that is coming out from Indiana. Now, both are starting to work on the Immortals, and once again, it's going to be the halfway point spawned by the Mighty Churros.
Yeah, they're in the lead here for the health pools, and Karazim is back in action. Cooldowns. There's no Apocalypse, no Cups, no Wrath of Berserker, no Hyperion, no Heroics on the side of Florida State.
That's going to be tough for them for sure. And now here comes Indiana going with the stun. And immediately they just find Zagara and take her out. And now look at the positioning for Florida State. This is going to be rough for them. Indiana trying to maybe keep them from getting back to their base.
All right, the Stormbolt does connect and they're looking to turn this around. It's a 4v5 in favor of the Mighty Churros and make that another hero down. Greymane is going to town with a go for the throat. The heals are good from Deathclaw, but not enough to save Phelps.
Oh, his Adrenaline Rush tried for so long to keep him alive as well. As the cups from Lili, but it still wasn't enough, and that will finally be the ticket to pushing back Florida State. And the amount of experience they've been able to get, Indiana's been able to get, not only with winning the Immortals, but also with being ahead on these kills, means they're getting to the point where they're starting to get ahead in the talent tiers pretty significantly. They're about to get level 13 right now.
Yeah, I mean, having a full talent tier advantage with this big Immortal in the top lane. The fort is already down, so now they're looking to take down those keep towers. It's a lot of experience, 1,300 in total if they manage to blow them up, and this is going to be a tough defense for Florida State.
They're going to try to make it happen. With both forts already down, this is going to start to push toward the keeps. Just one little measly tower standing in the way before the keep towers. And a very, very shielded Immortal Beleth is starting to push in towards these. And they've got a lot of poke damage to try to whittle down the towers fairly quickly so that he should still be able to push into the keep with quite a lot of health.
Yeah, we've really been highlighting that massive burst damage of Li Ming throughout this game. But now she has picked up a glass cannon. So she sacrifices 15% of her total hit points for 15% more ability power. So she's that much more of a, you know, powerhouse, but rather squishy in the backside of it.
We'll see if Indiana want to continue pushing with this. They do have the 13 advantage. It's still pretty healthy for Beleth. And with so many stuns, once again, Raynor gets eliminated. The Mighty Cups trying to keep, or Jug of the Cups trying to keep them alive.
Shambulance in the back, though. She got Li Ming. Glass Cannon really working against her in that moment, but Shambulance is a little bit too far forward, and Greymane picks up the kill. The keep will fall very early in this game, and if Dumbhawk goes down, this could be disastrous for Florida State Crab Legs.
What are they going to do? Are they going to try to end right here? It looks like they don't feel super comfortable without Li Ming. They're also fairly low on mana themselves, so they're going to be okay with just rotating back. They know that it's already such a huge advantage to have a keep down, to have those catapults pushing, and to be as ahead in experience as they are.
Gilly, the Muradin-Taranda-Greymane is the Crab Cruncher combo. They just go in and they get those vice grips on the crabs and just crunch them to pieces.
They've been doing a great job with that. I think they've found a hole in the plan of Florida State. You know, they really like this Diablo, but they're having a much harder time this time being able to deal with Indiana. So we may see if we go to a game three, Florida State try to switch things up. But for now, in this game, once again, teams, while the Immortal phase is done, trying to get as many mercenary camps as they can, trying to force a response from their opponents, hopefully to allow them to get into a better position once those Immortals once again spawn.
All right, look at this position. They know this is something that's expected to be done on the side of Florida State. Indiana ambushing from behind. We have the Dwarf Toss over the wall, the Storm Bolt, and the Lunar Flare, and another Crab Cruncher combo on Sonya.
Oh, she's going to be taken out, and that means that Greymane will be able to get that Khazra camp as well. It's just these bruisers thus far, and they're going to be cleared up pretty quickly. Florida State is pushing in the top. They know that they need to get the experience. They know that the Indiana is down at the bottom, so they're trying to get this fort, but they need to be careful as already the rotation's starting up from Indiana. They should be able to get this maybe and move away, and there is the Sentinel just going to see that they are indeed pushing back.
All right, so I love everything about Indiana's decision making and just map awareness so far in this game. They're punishing, you know, the obvious, you know, mistakes to go for those mercenary camps. They're grabbing this mercenary camp the moment that these Immortals are about to spawn, and now they will have a level 16 talent tier advantage, a 2-level advantage going into this next Immortal phase. The chance of Florida State getting this Immortal successfully is very low.
It is, especially without those 16s, and they have if they lose a big team fight and all of their heroes, it would be game over. So they know that they're in a very, very tough position. They want to be able to just get a pick. Even one, maybe two people would be enough that they could start to win this. But for now, they are going to start working down on Belleth. You know, we talked to both of these teams, and both said they didn't really have time to research each other. But it's Indiana who seems to be doing a really good job of adapting on the fly to the strategies of Florida State.
Yeah, definitely. And now look at the lanes. Top and bottom, both completely pushed out from the mercenary camps. Indiana just hit level 16. Florida State has to back up. They're sending Sonya to clean up the bottom lane. The top lane has catapults and fallen shaman, and that will start to pressure the core if it goes uncontested for too long.
Yeah, someone is going to have to go back there, and that's the moment when they strike, but actually they're gonna strike anyway, and Rainer taken out.
Man, that just feels bad to get blown up like that. Hunter's Mark coming into action here on the Immortal, and they chunk it down to the halfway point. Indiana dictating the pacing of this game.
Now, because the Immortal always pushes down the lanes with the most structures, it will still move to bottom. So they have another keep in the way, but if it continues being as strong as they've been, and I don't see why it wouldn't, as they've burned down Alarion, once again, they are looking at another keep, and they're back in the same situation where if they lose enough people, they're going to lose the game.
Yeah, this is tough. Now, Rainer about to respawn. They will have cups for that heroic ability on Lili in about 30 seconds, and then everything will be at their best. But they still do not have their level 16 talent, and they're against a 70% power Immortal. This is rough.
Yeah, and is that Executioner I see Greymane as well? So he's going to be doing 40% more damage to slowed, stunned, and rooted targets. And if there's one thing Indiana has, it's a lot of that.
Yeah, it's all about that blow-up style here for the team. They've drafted it two games in a row, and it looks like here on this map, it's working out nicely for them.
We're going to start pushing on. The tower's about to be taken out, and then they'll move into the keep. If they can get maybe a good, like, Apocalypse Devouring Maw combination, really separate some people out of the fight, that's exactly what Florida State would need. They need to be able to just separate out so they're not trying to fight a 5-on-5 without those 16 talents, but they are going to forfeit this keep for the most part, it looks like.
Yeah, Hyperion being spent there to try to buy them some space, but the moment it goes down, Lili will be blown up. The keep has fallen. The Immortal still standing, and Mighty Churros will look to end the game if possible.
Little Panda, what were you doing up there? You are now gone and not helping out with the team. They are about to at least take out Belleth, but meanwhile, Disintegrate starting to take down Diablo. He throws out Apocalypse, but already is taken out as well. The big arcane orb takes down Felb and Shambulance to half health, and they have to go back into their Nexus.
Okay, Souls for Diablo, so he's back in action trying to push them back. The catapults in the top lane are doing so much damage to the core, down to just 80% health. Zagara going to try to summon some minions. Yes, the minions do spawn in time to help push them back, but the big damage coming out from Li Ming. She's getting chunked down. Diablo, Shadow Charge, the flip, it's enough for a kill. Wilted will fall. The core is down to just 30% health, but only Karazim and Greymane remain. Karazim goes down. Greymane cannot end it, and they manage to defend. Florida State stays alive.
That devouring maw from Dumbhawk. Are you kidding me? That's exactly what they needed. That's exactly what I was saying. They pulled two people in and eliminated Li Ming during that time. They pulled apart Indiana, but now they're so far behind, Jake. There's still one fort up there. It looks to be that they want to push up maybe toward the keep and just do what they can. They have to take a keep down before they can go for core, and it's still 20-some seconds left. They can at least hopefully do that.
I love this idea to just go down the backside, take down this tower, knock down the wall, and try to burn through the keep. They have 20 seconds. I don't think it's a good idea to try to end the game here, but this will at least put them back in it. Now, their core is mega vulnerable at all times. It's going to make it very difficult, but with this keep falling, they're at least seeing some light.
Yeah, and that big deal too is that means that their own catapults will push up against the catapults of Indiana in the top lane. So it's a little bit less vulnerability against their core, but still, with so little health left, now the problem is a backdoor from Indiana.
Yeah, a backdoor. They could pretty much just throw their faces at the core and hope it's enough to destroy it, and it might work. But you see this bottom lane. I mean, Diablo already is down here trying to push it out. The shields have regenerated just about to full, so it's not as squishy as you might think, but it is still definitely a dicey scenario.
Once again, the setup is much quicker for Indiana at the Immortals. And Florida State know they have to fight at this, but they are at least back on the same talent here. They've caught up in experience. This is their moment to try to get in a team fight. Indiana realizes this, and they're backing off fast.
Okay, Hero has Dwarf Toss. Yes, he gets out to safety. Diablo able to zone, but the problem being is there's another mercenary camp in the top lane. Florida State has to send someone back there. If they lose their shields and take more damage on their core, it is far too vulnerable right now, and both lanes are completely pushed in.
The nice thing is once they show here, Indiana's going to push in and take out Illyrian to half health, but then it still be a little bit of time while they switch positions. So this is the time that Florida State can clear that out and get right back into the action once again to try to defend.
All right, they've stabilized their base for the time being, but they need a fight and they need it now. There's no level 20, teams are on even footing, but that Immortal is taking so much damage, but Mighty Churros are responding perfectly. They're not overcommitting to this. They know this is their game to lose.
Yeah, they are totally fine with backing off whenever, waiting until they see someone from Florida show someone else. You know, bottom lane, that's catapults pushing. Eventually, that would be something again that they'd have to respond to. And as long as they see Florida State defending their Immortal, they know that nobody's touching their own Immortal, and they can see whether the health bar is actually going down or not. It's not at all.
Okay, Hero gets a Storm Bolt onto Lili, but the fast feet will be more than enough for her to back away, and the team's just doing their best to whittle down that Immortal, down to just about 25% of its hit points. The Li Ming and Greymane poke has been very strong so far. It's all on Diablo to get that target, get the Shadow Charge, flip them back, and land an Apocalypse to dismantle the team before this Immortal goes down.
They can only deal with this for so long, and they realize that they're starting to push in. They need to be careful. The Sentinel goes out, shows the position of Florida State. Once again, they're going to back off and allow Indiana to come back in, throw down all of their abilities. There goes the orb and the magic missiles. And they've got to find somebody before it's too late, Jake.
I want to see, like, a cheeky Sonya flank or something. They're pushing them back. Take out that tower. It's giving them vision, applying a lot of damage. There's all these little things that Florida State could be doing a little bit better right now. Leaving that tower up is a big mistake so far in this game.
Yeah, they are at least a little bit ahead in experience. They could try to maybe get 20 and make something happen, but so far, Indiana has not let anything happen. Florida State are already trying to make it happen, but Indiana is so good at disengaging.
And there's a catapult on the core already right now, so the shields are starting to go down a little bit more. That bottom lane catapult advantage in favor of Indiana also coming into play since this has been drawn out so far. Just very safe passive play out of Indiana, and that poke of Li Ming is just continuously an issue.
Well, Jake, question has been answered, the tower taken out, and that gives Florida State a little bit more experience. They see one more tower that could give
level
them their
20.
Storm talents. Yeah, level 20, there it is.
Okay, This is rough. We know that core is very low. They now have the level 20 advantage. That's why we do see the Mighty Churros backing further and further back into their base. But that bottom lane is still such a big issue. There's no one that can go back and immediately re-enter the battle like Brightwing could in other games today. And Diablo goes in with the Bolt of the Storm, but does not get the target. A massive mistake there.
There goes Hero with the Dwarf Toss in, but I think I heard the rest of the team saying, don't go, don't go, don't go. We don't have 20. And they are just going to continue to back off.
They needed that. That was their play, and they just didn't manage to get it. And now these catapults are becoming quite an issue.
Yep, there goes the seven-sided strike onto Feraligatr, but he is fine. The Apocalypse will go down into a Devouring Maw that is on top of Muradin. Meanwhile, Shambulance onto Graves, trying to take out that support for the team. But still, they don't take anybody out on Indiana.
Yeah, Indiana, they're still sitting pretty. They want level 20, and again, they're sitting in a position where this is their game to lose, but Florida State looking to make that desperate push. This is the right call. They need to just do it now and make it happen. They do not have Maw, Apocalypse, any heroic at all.
Yeah.
So it's going to be very difficult when you consider that there are a few available on the side of Indiana.
Yeah, they have a lot of long heroic abilities, long cooldown timers, but still they're trying to make it happen. Feraligatr keeps going in, keeps trying to throw somebody back to his teammates. It's just not happening, man. I know that Florida State
has
legs, but Mighty Churros
are slippery.
Go
for the throat, goes in, the double go for the throat, and Dumbhawk is now in a really bad spot. Chris Paul looking to seal the deal. Two targets should be going down here on the side of Florida State, and Indiana might be able to clutch it out. They could just charge to the core, but they're going to get their trophy, the Immortal.
Yeah, they have the Immortal to push with now, and he's going to go into the center first and then start to push, but they're already going to start to go
in. Lunar Flare up top on Lili. She's definitely going to go down here. Greymane diving in a beautiful pickup. Indiana, Gilly, I think we're going to game three.
We are going to game three, Jake. That core is already very low. They're going to head straight to it, knowing that three members are down. Don't even really need to wait for that Immortal as they're charging in, but they still are making sure they make the safe play. When tuition is on the line, you know they want to make sure they're doing the right thing, but that will be it. Indiana takes game number two, and we will be going to the final match, the final game, Jake.
The dream, Gillyweed.
Yeah.
The dream of a game three. Indiana bites into the crabs of the Florida State crab legs and shows them that they have what it takes, you know, go to toe-to-toe.
Yeah, these teams are, I believe, one is a seed 8, and one is the 9th seed coming out of their region. So they're showing that they're very close in skill. And I love how Indiana was able to adapt to the strategies that the Florida State were using. So it's up to Florida State now to come back with that adaptation.
And man, that Tyrande play was just so on point all game long. And you know what? When we see good Tyrande play, that's only really powerful when it's paired with your ally. So when the Hunter's Marks were landing with the Lunar Flare, you would see that Greymane follow up. You would see that Leeming follow up. The team really on point with their communication throughout the game. And they just they knew how to play safe. So many teams would have gotten anxious and antsy to finish that Immortal in the top, and they might have lost in that scenario.
Yeah, that shows a more skilled team, a team who has been in longer, to be patient during that, especially, Jake, when you are down a game in this series and it's single elimination. To have that patience, to be able to take a deep breath and be okay knowing that you're so far ahead in this game, you just have to play it right, get to level 20, and then be able to win the game there, and they did. And Wilted's Tyrande play, you're right, was incredible.
Yeah. So really cool game. We're now tied up 1-1. But there is so much more going on than this one matchup. So be sure to check out heroesofthedorm.com. Heroes of the Dorm will actually be concluding with a live event in Seattle, Washington on April 9th and 10th. And you can actually attend that free or buy yourself your priority seating. So it's all available on heroesofthedorm.com. Check that out while we go to a quick commercial break. Stay tuned. Hello, friends, and welcome back here to Heroes of the Dorm, round of 64 with Gillyweed and SolidJake. What a game number two that was.
Yeah, Indiana really showing that even though they lost game number one, they were not out of it yet.
No.
They had a commanding lead that whole game, and they even had the patience to wait and make sure that they could clutch it out and at that level 20 point. So great job by them, and that means we get game number three between these teams. I am stoked.
I mean, just their approach for the blow-up style, the power of Tyrande on that map with Hunter's Mark for the Immortals to blow them up, it really worked out super nicely, and we saw the power of the Crab Cruncher combo, whatever we're going to call it, just that the mega stun lock with the burst damage follow-up every single time they were getting an early pick in those fights, which is really what allowed them to win that game.
Well, speaking of the Tyrande, let's take a look at the Tyrande player from last time. Wilted, this is the team captain, I believe, correct, Jake?
Shotcaller team captain, you know, kind of like the brains behind the whole team. And he was just executing flawlessly throughout the game. So he plays a lot of Falstad, Tassadar. You know, we talked about those control heroes. That's really what he goes for. But he's also their mid, they're like pseudo support. So the Tassadar, sometimes even Brightwing. The Tassadar, Tyrande are really his two pseudo supports that he likes to play.
Well, now we will be going on to a different battleground.
Yes.
And Battlefield of Eternity was the battleground choice for Indiana. Right, because they lost the first game. So then now we've got Florida State getting to choose where they will bring the battle to.
Right, so Florida State won on Sky Temple, which is actually our default battleground for game one in the round of 64. And they showed that they're very strong on that type of team fighting where it's a little bit more around a space and you can kind of disengage. You're not really pressed to eliminate the Immortal quickly.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a little bit different. So where do you think they'll take them, Gilly? You think we might be going to something like Black Hearts Bay?
Well, I actually have your answer for you.
Oh.
And it's pretty exciting. Exciting because we are going to Towers of Doom, the newest battleground in Heroes of the Storm.
I'm not ready for this. I hope you guys are, because Towers of Doom is an epic battle where the rules are changed. Actually, you cannot attack your enemy team's core. You have to capture the altars that spawn across the battleground, which will deal damage to your opponent's team's core. Once you've done a total of 40 damage to their core, you see the Mabards going in. Their core will fall and you will win the game, and there is no way to heal or let your shield regenerate your core whatsoever.
Yeah, it's a really interesting battleground because you can use the mercenary camp specifically, as we're seeing here, those pumpkin sappers. Obviously, they will run in and destroy structures, but if you can escort them in, they will also deal direct damage to the core. So everything is rounding out about being able to deal damage to structures in the core, while you're not able to actually do that yourself.
And the other thing that's kind of crazy about this map is the keeps and the forts, while they're actually considered bell towers. And again, the rules kind of change with those as well. If you destroy an enemy team's keep, you actually claim it as your own, and it empowers your altars to do additional damage.
Right.
So for every structure that you control, when you channel an altar, it will do one more damage, and one less for your opponents if they channel an altar if they only control, say, two bell towers.
And if you control all of the bell towers on the battleground, you will continually just fire some shots further onto the core until they can get one back. But I hear the draft is ready, so we'll see how these teams choose to approach Towers of Doom.
Alrighty, well, we're actually about halfway through this draft, and we're going to give you guys that inside look as to what's gone down so far. So Zagara, that powerful laner, the powerful zone control, has been banned out by Indiana. Then we saw the ban from Falstad, followed up by first pick of Thrall. Thrall's a very powerful solo laner, Gillyweed.
He is a very powerful solo laner, and taking out Zagara, another one, just enables them to be able to say, we're going to control that solo lane. Florida State have responded with Zul and Li Ming, though, and Zul, our newest hero, is a great laner as well. And then finally, once again, we're going to see Tyrande picked up by Indiana, as well as Jaina, for a lot of damage going into the next set of bans.
Yeah, so Tyrande on Wilted has like an additional power. So although he doesn't necessarily have Hunter's Mark for the Immortal, the Sentinel, that owl that he shoots across the map, can interrupt the enemy team that's channeling an altar from across the battleground, which is really powerful. But the Murd and Respect ban, you know, I love that out of Florida State.
Yeah, they see that the Tyrande, they know that Indiana have the power to make that combination work, and they're saying, no, thank you, we don't want to deal with that again. Now moving into the next phase of picks, Johanna and Raynor will be grabbed again. So again, with not having Thrall, they're making sure they get Raynor, and here we can see a little bit more about Raynor.
Yeah, so Raynor, he's like really self-sustainable, but he also can control a lot of space with the Hyperion.
Mm-hmm.
You summon that over a fight, one of those areas where the altar is, and he forces the enemy team to kind of scatter and back away. That allows your team to reposition, take control of that area, and take the fight as you please.
Yeah, the big deal on this is being able to stop the channels of altars. There's a lot of times where two or three will spawn. So if you're able to control a couple of those while your teammates are picking up a altar, then you can then move in with all of your members and be able to fight and hopefully get the advantage with those.
Alrighty, well, ETC has been picked up. Now, we talked about this even in the draft for last game. A lot of the times when you see Tyrande, you want Muradin or ETC. Mm-hmm. So he has a very similar effect. So I love this pickup here from Indiana. But do they go for another burst hero like Greymane?
I'm wondering if we'll see that or if they will run another support. You know, they ran Tyrande with Karazim last time. So I'm wondering
maybe
if they're
Brightwing?
Feeling confident. I would love to see Brightwing.
Ooh.
Brightwing is a pretty big favorite, actually, of Florida State, although we haven't seen it out of them just yet. But, yeah. Either way, I would love to have a Fairy Dragon on the field.
Well, Global Presence is certainly a powerful asset on this battleground, especially when you consider that's why we had the first ban on Falstad. Not only is he a strong hero, not only is Mighty Gust fantastic, but the power of that. Looks like they're sticking with the Karazim.
I mean, why change what works? So now we see the full draft for Indiana. What will Florida State grab as their last one? It will be a support of some type. Here is Karazim. He's got a lot of mobility with Radiant Dash. And as you can see, his trait changes. That's his level one talent that he gets to pick up. Doesn't that look nice?
What a handsome graphic.
So good.
Look at him, Divine Palming himself. He actually will resurrect if he dies while that is active. And return to battle. You see Vala, she should be dead there. But she says, no, I'm gonna stick in there, man.
Woo, there she is. Brightwing will be the choice in Global Presence. I was cheering, which is probably why we came back to me so much. I love my Brightwing.
Fairy Dragons and all her new icons and the graphic they made, she's a handsome hero for sure. But again, Brightwing, very, very much a powerful pick when you consider the power of that Global Presence, soaking the lanes, quickly responding to an altar with your team and getting in there. Look at those graphics,
so
Gilly.
Gorgeous. I love it. Yeah, her ability, recently she had Arcane Flare buffed a bit. It does a lot more damage, and being able to do that makes her pretty good in lane as well. So she actually can do a fairly good job at being able to push the waves as much as possible. And of course you want that for her because of the fact that she is going to be in lane for as long as possible until she teleports to her team to help them out at those altar fights.
Crazy mobility is the name of the game with Brightwing, and we'll see how it pays off here for the team, but she doesn't necessarily have the same kind of burst healing as some of the other supports in this game. So since we just saw a style where Tyrande was really putting a focus on blowing up the enemy team with the Power of Hunter's Mark, Brightwing has to scramble to throw out that Pixie Dust to sustain some of the ability power coming in or some of the big attacks coming in, as well as the Polymorph to lock out something like, a hero diving in for go for the throat or whatever it would be.
Yeah, we're going to see if they're able to make that work. It is a comfort pick for them, but I wanted to point out that we don't have the Diablo draft this time. So they are realizing that that strategy has been adapted to, and so it's time for them to do that as well. But Johanna is the next favorite for them if they can't get the Diablo, so it should still be something that they're fairly comfortable with. It's just not going to be, it's a much different style of play.
Well, it's going to be really fun to see it all wind down here. I mean, we have game three after game three today because these teams are so evenly matched, and they are bringing out all their new six strats here for the round of 64, because if you fall once, if you lose one match, your run here for Heroes of the Dorm is over.
It is over. Intuition is so important to these teams. It changes everything. You know, on the bracket reveal, we got to hear a little bit from Fan, who was a winner from last year, and how important it was to him to be able to get tuition and totally change his college career and then propel his pro gaming career forward from that.
Alrighty, guys. Well, it sounds like we are ready for game number three. Just kidding. We're still setting it up, making sure all the players are at their optimal, peak for performance. Their computers are ready to roll. They've greased up their hard drives, whatever that means. Have you ever greased up your hard drive?
I have not greased up my hard drive.
You should try it.
Yeah? You think it'll improve my computer?
I don't want to try it myself. But if you let me know and you tell me the results are decent, I might do it.
Okay, I'll let you know on that. I'll get back to you.
Thanks, Gillyweed.
Yeah, no problem. We'll have more on that tomorrow.
I can't wait.
Well, soon we will be on Towers of Doom. This is a choice for Florida State, of course. They did lose the last one, so it will be the place where they're feeling more confident with a draft that they feel pretty confident about. Some of their pocket picks with Brightwing and Johanna. And they do, I believe they also grabbed Azul, correct?
They did. Actually, I would love to take another look at the draft if that is all possible, so we can draw some more, synergies and whatnot that all exist in this game, because, man, we shotgunned through that so quick.
Here we are.
Getting another look at it if you're just tuning in. So we do see, again, Brightwing as that lone support. She does have, not necessarily the most burst healing, but look at the self-sustain that does exist on the opposing side. Rainer has a self-sustain. Johanna, very hard to eliminate with iron skin. Mm-hmm. Zul could go for the heals with his skeletons, the full skeleton build, which is pretty darn popular in the early states of this hero. And even Li Ming with diamond skin. I mean, she becomes very difficult to lock down when she's teleporting everywhere and getting those big shields.
Diamond skin as well as dominance. If she can start get some of those hero takedowns, then she would get 25% of her maximum health back with each and every one of those. So yeah, factoring in the fact that Brightwing's not known for just having crazy amounts of healing available in their draft. I really love that we've seen so much of the Zul as well as so much Li Ming. Li Ming is another one of Florida State's really pocket or happy picks, you know, confident picks if they can get them in the draft.
Yeah, and they're like the two newest heroes, so you pair them together and you throw that bone prison onto a target like Thrall that's gone in pretty far, and you say, hey, Li Ming, in 2 seconds, there's going to be a super vulnerable Thrall. Why don't you get in position and throw your missiles, which are going to be hard to miss, mm-hmm. in his face and blow him up?
Missiles, the arcane, or maybe even a disintegrate laser beam.
Oh my.
Start working on getting that critical mass for the resets for her abilities. But on the other side, Indiana, you know, they've got the great solo lane hero in Thrall. We've got a lot of burst potential too between Thrall, Jaina, and Tyrande. Once again, Wilted will be on Tyrande. So yeah, that's going to be really impressive to see.
Let's actually take a look at Thrall and talk about him a bit here in this moment. Now, Li Ming too. She's even cuter than Thrall. She's got her makeup and she's got her laser shows. When you watch a Li Ming play, it's basically like going to a rave in the Bronx because there's just purple lights everywhere and she blinks all over the place. And that's really, you know, just brings me back to college, Gillyweed.
Yeah, I don't want to hear more about that. So we'll move right on from that then, Jake. But thanks for giving us a little bit of insight. Here is Thrall. We've seen him quite a lot today. The big deal for him is Frost Wolf resilience. When he does damage with his abilities to heroes, it gives him stacks of that. And as soon as he gets to 5, he gets a heal. So the fact that he's able to have that self-sustained Wind Fury gives him some movement speed as well. So he can be all over the place, brings that root to a team composition. And then the Sundering is, of course, the big deal for Thrall.
You know, we call it Thundering for Thrall, but the enemy team, it's not so fun for them because we've seen it just outright win team fights throughout the day today. A very powerful linear ability. And when you think about some of the pathways that exist here on Towers of Doom, like when you're trying to funnel into one of those altar locations, it could really just spell your demise if you're not careful.
Yeah, all of them have choke points when you're trying to move into the altars. And there are 3 of them. There's 2 up in the top and then 1 in the bottom. But let's also talk about the boss on Towers of Doom.
The Headless Horseman.
The Headless Horseman, because he is insane. He is the strongest boss, I believe, out of all of the ones that we do have.
I would say so.
Yes, and those green skull-looking things that he puts on the ground do so much damage if you're standing on it. So you have to really be paying attention, which is kind of hard when you see the other team trying to like barrel in on you at the same time.
Yeah, he basically dumps a bucket of filth on the ground, and if you step in it, it ruins your shoes and your life on that. So you really want to make sure you do not step in that stuff, and you watch for the head that he throws around, because although he's the Headless Horseman, he still controls his head, and he can actually lob it around as a projectile, and it really does not feel good if you're on the receiving end.
Well, guys, we do have a little bit of technical things going on. One of the players dropped out of the lobby, so we're just remaking that to make sure we have all 10 players, which is something that you tend to want in Heroes of the Storm.
It sounds like we've actually reconnected. Oh. We're ready to roll, so let's hop right into game number 3 on Towers of Doom between Florida State and Indiana.
All right, so here they are starting to move in to the gates. Florida State are going to have Zul, Rainer, Johanna, Brightwing, and Li Ming. Meanwhile, Indiana with Tyrande once again, as well as Jaina, Karazim, Thrall, and ETC.
This is it. One team will move on to the round of 32, and one team's hopes and dreams will be shattered as they will fall out of the tournament and have to wait for another chance next year.
The gates are open. The countdown has finished, and they're starting to push in. We'll see how the laning setup will be for each team. Already, Florida State, they're separating out. They just want to get into the lanes, be safe. They know that there are a lot of stuns and roots available, as well as with Tyrande. That early game for Indiana is very strong, so they're realizing they just want to get back into their lanes immediately and stay safe versus trying to get into a big fight.
But I love this early game pressure. Now, once again, I really feel that the level 1 power is in favor of Indiana.
Yeah.
If they manage to find anyone out of position, they will quickly and promptly blow up their life.
And that's why we see them. They're going to try to rotate around wherever possible. And they know that there's going to be quite a few heroes into the bottom. So if they can try to not only stop this push as much as possible, but also grab somebody on those rotations, even if they're not there, the fact that they are rotating back and forth puts a little bit of fear in Florida State. They don't want to get caught knowing that those rotations are coming down. And once again, Tyranda and ETC starting to make their way to the bottom. Everyone from Florida State rather out. Can Hero grab someone with a power slide into a face melt? Looks like Deathclaw will be the one, but actually face melts him out of the Lunar Flare. Doesn't matter. Brightwing still gets taken out. First blood for Indiana.
Yeah, great on Kaze to rotate around, throw out that Cone of Cold, and pick up the kill. Really amounting to a nice pickup, and that's not really going to give them a strong advantage by any means. It's really just going to put the fear into them to really say, hey, if you pass that halfway mark in the map, you're going to be in for a world of hurt, because we're going to hunt you and we're going to ruin your life.
I will find you and I will take you out. And once again, we see them rotating in as well, but this time we won't be so lucky. Oh. Or will they? Because the Lunar Flare still hits Shambulance at the gate. But they're able to get back. But man, they just have to play so safe right now, Jake.
Yeah, the fact that we actually saw that we had to have the well tap there for Li Ming right as the first altar is about to spawn. It's only a single altar. So that's an opportunity that's been taken away. And now even Dumbhawk going to take a ton of damage from that Lunar Flare combo coming out. But a big polymorph on Kaze. Jaina does not have the most mobility, but will have the peel from Hero.
Now, they did at least trade out some damage, too, so they might force a couple of well taps themselves, and they do as that ultra was spawning. They don't really have time to go all the way back. Now, Feraliator starting to just zone as much as possible. He wants to be able to soak some of the abilities to allow his teammate to be able to pick up the ultra, but I don't know if that's going to happen as they're already taking damage, Jake.
Okay, Phelps getting very low, but we do see his self heal does go off, so General Rush keeping him topped off. And so far, the altar has not been grabbed quite yet. We saw Wilted with a nice owl. We see the full Sentinel build on Tyranda to really just help them keep denying the altar captures from afar.
Bone Prison has gone down onto ETC. He's fairly safe in there, though. He's going to power slide straight in, and Phelps is in trouble this time. Raynor gets taken out.
Beautiful combo there. Wilted on point with that Lunar Flare, but there's so many low targets, and the double support not really showing off to be enough, or just as I say that, yes, it is for Alligator. Barely stepping away with that Iron Skin. Graves going to try to secure the kill, but this is a risky maneuver.
Yeah, Skeleton, or the Pumpkin Sapper, is actually helping out, throwing a couple of damage onto Feraligatr. But yeah, this is finally going to push Florida State back. They're doing a good job of trying to avoid all of the abilities. But once again, Spectral Scythe comes in. If Florida State could just hold on, maybe one more interrupt, but I don't think they're going to have it here. They know it's too risky, and the first altar will be picked up by Indiana.
All right, so Indiana, they're sitting on a nice experience lead from the two kills they've picked up in this game. They're now splitting up, making sure they can go back and maintain their soak in this map. But they do need to send someone to top lane very quickly, and it will be Thrall, the strongest solo laner on their team, to do so.
Yeah, oh wow, this push has been pretty insane.
Dumbhawk.
Dumbhawk in trouble, does use the Bone Prison to get away from that Wind Fury in the nick of time, as well as the Bone
that
Armor.
That was dicey.
That was very dicey.
Okay, a nice power slide in. Lunar Flare combo onto Brightwing. Deathclaw will be the one that dies here. And another third pickup here. I mean, this constant rotation of Tyranda in ETC is proving to be disastrous for this Brightwing player.
Yeah, once again, they've lost their support player. Yes, she can phase shift back in. But at a certain point, these are really going to start catapulting Indiana ahead in experience. Already, they're getting closer to those level 7 talents. And that's really important for them to be able to be up those talent tiers whenever the altar phase spawns.
Yeah, so a few things to point out just stylistically. It's actually a little bit early game here and team fight oriented on the side of Indiana. I mean, generally, when you actually see this build on Thrall, you might be a little bit surprised because it's not really designed for strong laning. It's designed for early ganking and getting those kills on the enemy team. But also, Snowstorm from Jaina controls so much space in these chokeholds.
Yeah, that big 30% increase in the radius is going to be really great for them. If she can throw that down into the chokeholds, then it's much more likely, because they'll be slowed moving through, that she'll be able to make sure that the opponents get hit by both of the waves of the blizzard.
Now, if you think you're hearing an elephant at home, that's actually just ETC playing us some lovely music. And we are all, you know, fortunate enough to hear that all game long.
I know how much you really love the sound effects of that skin tint. But now we do have the next altar phase spawning. Bone Prison goes down, and Jaina taken out just as this altar phase is about to spawn in the bottom. That's big for Florida State.
Yeah, we talked about the synergy with those two heroes. Once that Bone Prison is cast on a target, they are imminently going to be vulnerable unless a cleanse is spent. Now, if Karazim had been around, he could have, kind of gotten a hold on that situation, but they managed to trade out Brightwing again. I believe that is her fourth or third death this game, Gillyweed.
And this poor fairy dragon cannot catch a break, but at least she did distract some of the members of Indiana, so Florida State did get their own altar. Both teams pretty close in experience, picking up the mercenary camps and making sure that they are not losing out on lane soak anywhere. It's very important. Indiana doing a good job of that, but now Florida State needs to start to rotate back out as they want to make sure that they do have their heroic abilities at about the same time, especially if another altar phase comes right around them.
So we do need to point out that the early altars aren't really super impactful. At the end of the day, I mean, as long as you still have 4 health on your core, you haven't lost.
Mm-hmm.
So it's 36-36, but what matters the most is the experience in this game. Now, Chris Paul, Polyp, and Hit by the Bone Prison should be going down here, but no, the self-sustain of that Thrall sufficient for him to get away.
I really like the Li Ming build that we have coming out. It is going to be the Calamity style where her teleport does do some damage. She realizes how aggressive Indiana has been thus far and that she needs to play pretty safely once she gets Illusionist that will give her more range on the teleport. And then she doesn't have the dominance that we mentioned. There was the teleport, but it's not far enough to get her back behind the gate. And they are able to eliminate Li Ming.
Just great response there. The Lunar Flare was placed perfectly to either force her back or force her into it. And the moment that she stepped back, it gave enough time for ETC to get up there with the Power Slide, guaranteeing that kill in the pickup there for Indiana, who now have their heroic abilities at level 10.
Look at those heroic abilities too. Mosh Pit, Sundering, Ring of Frost, and Members in a lot of trouble.
Not like this.
The Mosh Pit already out too, and Graves kicking Zul to death just as the altar phase spawns, and it's going to be two of them. Florida State need to get their heroic abilities, and they need to get Zul back.
Champions! Good night.
Sweet Li Ming. They're just going to grab this altar and move right back to the other one. I mean, it's a few seconds until Zul's up. Now they don't have Li Ming, a big damage dealer. They just have Rainer, Brightwing, and Johanna. And they're going to have to give up a lot of shots onto their core right now.
Yeah, I mean, losing two altars in a phase this early in the game is really going to put you in a tight spot. Down to 28 health. I mean, it's not the end of the world, but it drains on your mentality a lot because it's like, all right, guys, we really need to kind of re-catch up. We're down a full level. We're down a lot in our core health, and we need to get a team fight before level 13.
Yeah, this is the time that really shows the caliber of teams. When they get behind in a game, not what we call tilting, not starting to get upset, Hero looking for Deathclaw, Blink's heal over to the minions. She has one more shot of it and we'll be able to get through. Now that is a Ring of Frost, but they're still rooted behind the gate. And for now they've been able to survive versus so many heroic abilities used from Indiana.
So Deathclaw, yeah, you'll notice that level 10 ability Blink heal allows her to get out of a lot of bad spots. She has been the target, the priority target for Indiana all game long.
Mm-hmm.
But now they might have to change up their strategy because you saw how easily Brighton was able to juke their abilities and get back to safety. Many heroics were spent in that main Hyperion and the Ring of Frost, but at the end of the day, I mean, that's not the biggest of deals in this matchup.
Right, and now getting back out into the lanes, getting some mercenary camps, you know, if they could start to escort these pumpkin sappers a bit more, they could start to look toward picking up some of the bell towers away from their opponents, looking to get more shots. You know, as we get later into the game, those towers that have been in front of the bell towers have been taken out, so it gets a bit easier for you to be able to get a big push, and it looks like that might be the case for Indiana down into the bottom lane.
Okay, well, we do see Thrall will be rotating down, and Zul is being left alone in the top. So if there's no strong push awarded here on the side of Indiana, this will be kind of a bad situation for them because Zul is really causing an issue in that top lane all by himself.
Yeah, I think they thought maybe that they could out-push him, but so far, that was not the case. He got a lot of health about half away from the bell tower. Realizing that they're rotating out, they saw them leaving, they called for him to come back, and now the altars are both in the bottom, so they're going to need to have him come down, and it might be a little bit of time where Florida State needs to stall from Indiana, especially because they don't have 13, so they're finding themselves once again down a really pivotal point right as the altars are about to spawn.
Okay, well, we could see something cheeky happen, a nice phase shift in, giving that peekaboo, all that vision from that radius you see, the pulsing blue on the side of Florida State. They have a good idea that they're safe to move on in for Alligator, trying to get the channel, but Hero looking for a big mosh pit, but he only gets the one, and the Sundering working against him.
Oh, a little bit of a misstep there as well, losing it, but they're still about to take out Deathclaw yet again. Dumbhawk trying to do what he can, but still taking a bunch of damage from it, having to go so far in. Zul goes down as well as Thrall. It's a 1-for-1 ETC being chased down by Phelps. And he will be able to help Graves get to safety with the Radiant Dash. So a one for one, not too bad, but still Florida State does not have the same talent here as Indiana.
Li Ming is channeling that bottom altar, so it does get picked up here on the side of Florida State, but they do end up losing Rainer in the process. So now there's a hero advantage on the side of Indiana, and they still have that full level lead. Shambulance, this is a risky move, my friend, and you will pay dearly with it.
Oh, but she's gonna try to at least help her team maybe take out Hero. Won't even get that. And finally, this mid altar will be channeled by Wilted. So now they traded out evenly, so it wasn't too bad for Florida State. They are definitely behind in the core health and behind about a level. So they really need to make sure they're trying to get whatever soak they can. If they could maybe start to get some picks, you know? We mentioned both Zul and Li Ming, if they can start to rotate around, find somebody maybe out of position with the Bone Prison and take them out that way, that would give them a lot of good comeback experience.
It certainly would, and they need it desperately. But fortunately, they're still on a talent tier advantage, and they're not that far behind when it comes to the core health.
Mm-hmm.
So all things considered, it's anyone's game at this point. We just need to see some more aggressive plays on the side of Florida State. They're always the ones being attacked. They're always the ones that are being chased after, and never are they trying to make something like that happen on their own. I'd like to see Zul and Li Ming team up rather than just Zul push on his own and try to get some of those kills like we saw earlier this game.
Ooh.
This is exactly what they need. Kaze getting picked off is phenomenal here for Florida State.
Yeah, man, use Brightwing to her advantage. She came in, she face shifted, and then all of a sudden they had two members against one. This keep was already low too, so they're going to be able to get four shots now when they pick up an altar. They're even going to get some of these pumpkin sappers up top, whether they'll choose to help escort them or just make Indiana have to respond to this. But now finally Florida State have caught up in experience, so they can feel more confident in getting into fights versus Indiana.
Yeah, and for the first time in this game, we actually see that disparity in the bell tower. So 5 damage if an altar is channeled for Florida State, where only 3 damage would be done on the side of Indiana if they successfully get an altar. They also have the sappers marching down the top lane,
right,
which could end up going over the finish line and doing some permanent damage to the core if they're not responded to.
Yeah, and Indiana realized that, so they had to send a whole bunch of people back to deal with this, a whole bunch of people probably to deal with the bell tower, and look where the altar spawned, all the way into the bottom. And this is what we see teams do. Once they see their opponents trying to deal with a bell tower that's been taken, they push in another lane and try to just keep the pressure on at all times. Florida State are coming back into this game.
Yeah, I mean, suddenly Florida State, they're actually coming from being a full level down to about to have a level advantage just slightly over their opponents. We do see the Sentinel having that power to interrupt the channel of the altar from across the map, but this bottom bell tower is completely exposed, like you mentioned.
Indiana does have 16. The altars was picked up by Florida State. And another talent I wanted to point out that Florida State has on Rainer is Relentless Leader. Not only does it give it Relentless, where those disabling effects are only 50% as long, but every 5 seconds, if he is stunned, he pushes people away. So it's a really great pickup against an ETC with
Dumb Hawk. He's in a bad spot, and he will be blown up very quickly here. The seven-sided strike is doing wonders.
Wow.
And we even see Deathclaw face shift in and get blown up as well. So what looked like a good comp turnaround from Florida State, now they're well on their back foot once again.
Now, how do Indiana respond? It looks like with the boss, they're going to start to take it, and you can see the head, the green spot on the ground as well, but they're still, with the Hunter's Mark, going to take it out very quickly, and that will be more shots heading to the core of Florida State.
All right, so that's going to put them down to just 20 health remaining. Their core is officially halfway through its health pool, and now they are still down that experience. An invade about to happen from Indiana, forcing them off these pumpkin shamblers, or the sappers. And we do see ETC trying to dive in, but a great response from Fur Alligator.
All you have to do is get behind that line, and if a hero from the opponent team moves behind that line, they'll start taking a bunch of damage from the laser beams, the shots. So they were at least able to get back. That would have been really detrimental to them had they lost heroes, because they would have had these delayed respawn timers from the rest of the team, which are getting a lot longer since we're getting into the later game.
Yeah, it's true. I mean, every death becomes that much more problematic at this point. And let's get a bit of an update on these builds. So penetrating round going to give Rainer a lot more control now that they do have level 16. And when we have the amplified damage received from jailers, they have that Hunter's Mark of their own.
Mm-hmm.
So Zul, again, I want to see Zul being a key element in rotating to try to find heroes out of position and pick them off. And look at this, both teams waiting in respective bushes where they are hidden from their opponent's vision to try to ambush them.
Who will be the ones to move out first? It looks like Florida State.
Dumbhawk, I'm so no! Dumbhawk will be blown up here. There should have been a flashlight shine there from Johanna into the bushes, but it didn't happen. Hyperion has to be cast in desperation. The Ring of Frost is good, but not enough, and two heroes will go down for Florida State.
That's huge for Indiana. Now they're going to pick up one altar, two altars as they rotate over two. Still 40 seconds until Johanna will be back into the battle. And, I mean, Florida State just have to do what they can. You know, they have some lanes that they can push. They have some experience they can try to soak. But where we thought they were coming back in, Indiana immediately said, no, that is not going to be the case. We are controlling this game. We want to move on.
This is tough. Three more altars, based on the current layout of the map, would end the game in favor of the Mighty Churros. That's how map works, Gillyweed. And actually, with that altar going down in the bottom, it's becoming even more dicey. We're going to see the Pumpkin Scepters be escorted down to try to get three more damage dealt to the core of Florida State. And this is going to be a forced fight, which is great for Indiana.
I love that Brightwing is up in the top trying to soak, bring some experience back to Florida State. But here is the escort. Are they into position to defend this? Brightwing is teleporting in to try to help, throwing out whatever area damage they have on it, avoiding the blizzard. They are going to be able to take these out, though. It does force the response, at least. So they have pulled Brightwing all the way down from soaking experience in the top. So that's a good little win for Indiana.
And they can flank this. The Sundering just came off cooldown, and as did Ring of Frost. They didn't actually have that just a moment ago. So they're looking for a big flank. Hero going down with a power slide on three. Sundering dismantling the team, and Ring of Frost zoning them back. Rainer will end up falling. Deathclaw is on a very vulnerable spot in the bottom right, and we do see Zul will fall as well.
I love that Wilted threw out his Sentinel just as he knew they were about to engage, giving perfect vision to his team to know exactly how to come into that fight and really taking out Florida State.
Oh, the triple alters!
That's a scary phase.
Yeah, so this could be game. If Indiana manages to control all three, they will successfully end it here. Deathclaw gets caught by the Lunar Flare, but barely survives the onslaught of Indiana.
This is hard for Florida State. I mean, yes, it's a triple alter phase, so it would really require Indiana to spread out or move pretty slowly to get them all, but still they're down Storm Talons, which Indiana have just picked up. They have so much at their dispersal to try to stop this.
All right, beautiful Sentinel to disrupt that. The bottom altar being channeled and the right side altar. Jaina and Thrall pick those up respectively. Now this has to be stalled out here at the top left side while the team rotates in. Only two health remaining on the base of Florida State, and if they manage to pick this up, they will end it all. Bless Shield being cast, trying to zone it desperately, but the Sentinel is too powerful. The rewind there from Tyrande really paying off.
That's the power of Pierce. You can't block that Sentinel.
Three
now there is the Sundering into stuns. Ring of Frost comes out and Brightwing is gone, as is Johanna as well. And this looks like it could be game, Jake. There's only three members trying to defend this. They will defend to their last breath. They know that this is all it needs, but that will be it, guys. What Indiana was down at the beginning of this series, but they channeled the final altar, and they will be the ones moving on to the round of 32.
Congratulations to Indiana, bringing it back and just kind of getting their things together. They showed how powerful the utility of Tyrande is in both matches. Hunter's Mark on the Immortals, the Sentinel to disrupt and buy time for all of those altars left and right, and it really came through in the end.
Tyrande is a difficult hero to master as well, so the fact that we're seeing this come out of a collegiate team, Wilted was on fire this match. He really enabled his team to be, I mean, all of the team played fantastically, but Wilted really enabled the team to be able to pick up so many kills because of her follow-up stuns and being able to keep somebody from getting back to their base. A fantastic play from him. I have to give him a shout out.
Yeah, and some really cool stylistic options. I mean, we saw Skeletal Mages busted out for the Zul player to control a lot of space with the zone. We saw the power of Apocalypse to really dismantle teams, but in the end, it wasn't enough. And unfortunately, Florida State, their run has come to an end. But congratulations on playing so well and making it to the round of 64.
Their round is in, but it will be Indiana who gets to go to the round of 32, so they're one step closer to the Heroic Four, which will be in Seattle, a live event. It's going to be a lot of fun.
Well, guys, it sounds like we're ready for an interview with the man himself, Wilted. Welcome, my friend. Congratulations on such a phenomenal performance.
Thank you.
So tell us a little bit about Tyrande. Do you like her a lot?
Yeah, I was actually a support main for a really long time. So Tron's like a big comfort pick for me, and I really like drafting it. We play really well around it. So
in terms of synergies for Tyranda, do you think there's a lot of options? You guys really lean towards the Muradin ETC to make sure you have the lockdown? Or, you know, we saw the power of that with Grey Main too. Is that a part of the factor of the way that you drafted?
Yeah, usually we try to go for Muradin Tyran because just obvious synergies between those heroes. Yep. But we've run Diablo in the past, and we actually don't mind running Johanna with it. I think with like slows or like Jaina, it's good for setting up stuns. You can read a lot of movement of players, and so it's not too hard to get stuns with slows. And you know, just burst on top of Tyran is disgusting, and it's really hard to deal with. So.
Wilted, Gillyweed here. We talked to you earlier, and you had mentioned that it looked like it was a pretty even match with Florida State, but as long as you guys played your game and played calmly, then you would be able to pick up the series. And that's exactly what you did. How difficult was it for you guys to stay calm, though, after losing game one?
Game was a little rough for us. I didn't expect their draft with the Thrall Zul, and I think that was a big part of why we lost that game.
Mm-hmm.
But we had a lot of experience with this last year in our round of eight run. We'd always drop the first game and come back and win the next two. And that was like a common thing for us. So we've been through it a lot, but we can shake the nerves out and we're good to go.
Well, congratulations to you guys. You're moving on to the round of 32. Is there anybody that you are concerned about facing in your group?
Yeah, definitely. I'm assuming we're going to face UConn next, and it's definitely going to probably be the hardest match. I think that's one of the biggest matches in our top bracket C, I guess. So should be a fun match.
Well, good luck to you guys in that, and congratulations yet again.
Thank you.
Well, great job to them. Yeah. Good to hear from Wilted. They seemed pretty calm. It's exactly what they said they needed to do.
And they did it well. Well, guys, we are not done yet. We've got many more matches coming up, so let's take a look at what we have left for you today. Up next, we have the Ohio State Bucks versus UCLA Kyle's Kimchi. That sounds delicious.
Yeah, we're yet more food. We're continuing that theme. And then next we will have the hot dogs versus four guys and a dog, which will be Trikslyr and...
What? I mean, that's a beautiful name. That is just as good as it gets, my friends. Hot dogs and guys and dogs, it's all good. And then last but not least, Carolina University versus VCU will round out the round of 64 for us today. But of course, that's not just it for the competition. We've got much more after that tomorrow. Sunday, March 20th, will be the round of 32 at 10 a.m. EDT. Saturday will be the Super 16 on March 26th at 9 a.m. And then we have our Epic 8 at 2 p.m. on March 27th.
Well, if you guys want to know more about this, actually, there is the live event right here. It will be in Seattle, Washington at the CenturyLink Event Center, the Heroic Four and Grand Finals on April 8th, 9th, and 10th. It's going to be a fantastic event, and we will know who is going to win, who will walk away with tuition.
Yeah, and if you can't remember all those dates, numbers, times, and locations, just head on over to heroesofthedorm.com for all the information pertaining to the bracket, the teams, and all the schedule. It's all the good stuff. We're going to throw to a quick commercial break to set up for our next matchup. So stay tuned. There's plenty more action coming at you.